Welcome to Algebra 1AB. Today we've got section 2.2. This is our first day with solving inequalities using adding and subtracting. All right, so first of all, inequalities, we saw them yesterday. We practiced graphing them and describing how the numbers compared if they are unequal, greater than or less than. Now we're going to look at equations, or they what look like equations, except instead of an equal sign, they have one of those inequality symbols. And the first property that we're going to cover here is solving inequalities using addition. So what they're saying is if I have an inequality and I add the same number to each side, then it does produce an equivalent inequality. In other words, it keeps that inequality balanced. Right? Likewise, if I subtract the same thing from both sides, just like I would with an equation, it keeps the inequality balanced and makes an equivalent one. So we are allowed to subtract the same number from each side as well. Okay. Here we've got four problems to practice solving each inequality using addition or subtraction. So now, again, think about what x plus 3 equals 4. We've had some practice solving equations like that. We should feel pretty confident with those. We're going to treat this the same way, except instead of equals, we have an inequality sign. So this kind of determines the two sides of our inequality. Well, I want to get to a point where it's x compared to a number. So I want to undo the plus 3, subtract 3 from both sides, just as if it were an equation. I'm left with just an x on the left. It's a less than problem, 4 and negative 3. I can combine those like terms to make a positive 1 on the right. So my solution is x less than 1. And of course, that means that x can vary. It's a variable, so it means any numbers that are less than 1. For letter B, here we would add 3 to both sides, and I get x is greater than or equal to 8. Now, for letters C and D, there's a little caveat here, a little catch. Here I'm solving for x, so I would want to get the minus 2 undone. So I have 6 is greater than x. This is an acceptable solution. But what if we had to graph that? Having to graph 6 is greater than x is kind of a tricky one to graph. What it was nice about yesterday is that everything was in the format where the variable was on the left. So what I want you to imagine doing is taking this and just flipping it so that the x is out front. So we want x compared to 6. Well, how would that look? Look at our inequality symbol. It's a greater than symbol originally, but the point is headed toward the x. I need to keep that true and flip the sign as I flip x and 6. Now I have easily set up an inequality that I could graph very, very easily based off of what we learned yesterday. So with letter D, let's try that again. I want to solve for x, so I would subtract 1 from both sides. I then have negative 3 is less than or equal to x. And if I flip the whole thing, I've got my x out front, my negative 3 at the end on the other side, and the inequality sign is opening toward the x. Now, I say this again. This, what we had up above, is an acceptable answer, but if we were asked to graph it, it's much easier to graph it if we flip it first. All right, so here we are doing just that. It says solve the inequality and then graph the solution. So for problem 1, we'll go through this one together, and then I've got some for you to try on your own as well. So for number 1, if I want to solve for x, I would add 3 to both sides, and x is less than negative 1. Okay, so on our number line, somewhere in the middle, we'll put that negative 1 that we start with. And really, that's the only label we need, but we could add more numbers if we wanted to get a better feel for what the number line's doing. So at negative 1, I need to ask myself, is it a open or a closed circle? At negative 1, it is just a less than sign, so I know that means an open circle. And then I need to know, do I shade to the left or to the right? And since it's all values less than negative 1, I want numbers that go to the left from negative 1. Okay. Here's one that, again, you can see our variable h is off to the right. Well, if I want to solve for h, what I will do is add 3 to both sides. Oh, and that cancels on both sides. That means 0 is greater than h. And if we flip it so it's easier to graph, h is less than 0, right? That inequality sign has to point towards the h according to how we solved it. And again, let's put some labels on our number line here, just a few. I know at 0, I've got my point, and is it open or closed? It's just a less than, so it will be, oops, made it too small. It will be open, and I want values less than 0, so it will be going to the left. All right, problems 3 and 4, I'd like you to try these on your own. We're adding a little bit more to them, but I think we've covered the ideas behind solving these inequalities that I think you should be able to handle them. So take a minute, pause the video, come up with some solutions, and I'll check back in a couple seconds. All right. Well, the first thing I would do in number 3 is you can see they have minus a negative 1. I would rewrite that equation as s plus 1 is greater than or equal to 2, and then solve for s. Right, we want to simplify each side before we start moving things from one side to the other or treating both sides equally. So I want to subtract 1 from both sides. Now that's pretty easy to see. S is greater than or equal to positive 1. So that's our solution. And how we would plot that out, we would mark where 1 is on the number line. Since it's greater than or equal to, it would be a solid dot. And because it is greater than or equal to, we go to the right. For number 4, here again we can simplify the left-hand side. 6 minus 9 is negative 3. We've still got our plus u on the left-hand side, and that's less than negative 2 on the right. I would add 3 to both sides and find that u is less than 1 is the inequality I arrive at. So again, I put a 1 on the number line. It is less than, not or equal to, so it's an open circle, and less than means to the left. All right. Now on your homework, the number in the middle where the point is occurring, that's really the only one we have to have labeled, but if you wanted to add extras around just to get a feel for the numbers getting smaller or larger, that's always encouraged as well. We can have more than one step. So for number 5, again, I want you to pause the video and try these on your own, but I'll check back within a few seconds with the solutions. Just think, we want to simplify each side, combine like terms first. Pause the video, try these, I'll come back in a couple seconds. All right, so I noticed that the left-hand side is just fine. The right-hand side, though, I've got 4 C's and then I take away 3 C's. I can combine that to make 1 C, or just call it C, and I still got that positive 10. Now I'm good to go solving-wise. I'd subtract 10 from both sides, find that 2 is less than or equal to C, but that's not easy to graph, so I want to flip it so the variable's on the left. So I have C compared to 2, and my inequality symbol has to open toward the C. Okay, now I know my number line, here's 2. I want greater than or equal to, so it's a solid dot, and I go to the right. For number 6, we've got quite a bit of cleaning up that we can do on both sides. I've got a negative 7p plus 8p, so I've got that positive 15 along, and when I combine like terms, I get plus 1p, greater than, and then 15 minus 2, I can clean that up as well. It's 13. Now I can solve for p, just subtract 15 from both sides. P is greater than negative 2. Now I'm going to plot negative 2 on my number line. I want all numbers greater than. This was fortunate. We had our variable on the left, so I can read that as all numbers that are bigger than negative 2. Open circle, go to the right. All right, solving real life problems. Here we have inequalities that are represented in real life. You have $15 to spend on groceries. You have $12.25 worth of groceries already in your cart, right? An inequality that represents how much more money, M, you can spend on groceries, and then B, solve that inequality. All right, well, I know that I have $15 to spend. I cannot spend more than 15. So M is the money that we have left to spend. The money that we have left to spend plus the $12.25 we've already spent, those are all already in our cart, that has to be less than or equal to the $15 that we have total, right? I can't put so many items in my cart that I have over $15 worth. I won't be able to pay for them. So there is our inequality, letter B. If I'm going to solve that, letter B here in blue, we will subtract 12.25 from both sides. And I find that M is less than or equal to 2.75. And again, that is money, so we will put a dollar sign for units. So what we can spend is anything that is $2.75 or less. Next one, a circuit overloads at 1,800 watts of electricity. You plug a microwave oven that uses 1,100 watts of electricity into the circuit. Write and solve an inequality that represents how many watts you can add to the circuit without overloading it. So kind of like our money, we couldn't go over 15 before. Now we can't go over 1,800. Okay, so let's let W equal the how many watts. That's what we're trying to answer, what we're solving for. How many watts? Well, the watts that I have left plus the 1,100 that the microwave's already using has to be less than or equal to the 1,800 watts that that circuit allows. I'm going to solve that for W. I would subtract 1,100 from both sides. And W is less than or equal to 700 watts. So whatever else I plug into that outlet has to use 700 watts or less if I don't want to overload that circuit. Letter B, in addition to the microwave oven, which of the following appliances can you plug into the circuit at the same time without overloading the circuit? So remember, what we can plug in, our watts have to be less than or equal to 700 in order to stay under that maximum wattage. So we could plug in the clock radio, the blender, and then the hot plate. Well, that's 1,200 watts. That would overload the circuit, so we can't plug in that. And the toaster is just barely over 700 watts. It's 800 watts. So that would overload the circuit as well if we used it at the same time as the microwave. So the clock radio or the blender are allowed without overloading the circuit. Number seven, the microwave oven uses only 1,000 watts of electricity. Does this allow you to have both the microwave and the toaster plugged in at the same time? Explain. So the microwave oven, it says on the box 1,100 watts, but it actually only uses 1,000. Well, can we have both of them plugged in? Well, let's see what the toaster used. So the toaster uses 800, and if the microwave uses... So if our microwave uses 1,000 and the toaster uses 800, does M plus T fall into that less than or equal to 1,800 watts total? Well, now we're testing and see, does this inequality hold true? So M, 1,000 plus T, the toaster, 800, is that less than or equal to 1,800 total watts? If I combine like terms, is 1,800 less than or equal to 1,800? Yes, it is. So, yes. And yes, we are allowed to have both of them plugged in at the same time because both of those will fall within our allowed wattage. Okay, 15, here is the homework assignment for section 2.2, day 1.